In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, please be seated. Today is a day of triumph, a day of triumphant entry. Triumphant entry is where we know we've already won the war. The war may still have battles ahead, but the war itself is won. I know none of you remember, but all of us can remember the story of when the Allies triumphantly entered into Paris, after liberating Paris in World War II. Omar Bradley, led the American army through the city of Paris, through the Arc de Triomphe, because they had won the war. They already knew that much suffering and battles lied ahead of them, but they knew that the war was won because they had stormed the Normandy coast, they had already conquered North Africa, and they had already conquered the Italian peninsula, and they had already conquered Paris. Conquered it, liberated it, they called it. And General Charles de Gaulle was there with them, claiming the credit for it. Jesus enters into Jerusalem today to take possession of the temple. And he cast out the money changers and those who would turn his holy church into a den of thieves. He had seen what those Pharisees and scribes and hypocrites had done to that which is erected to the worship of God the Father. And he had seen that they had corrupted it. How did they corrupt it? Is the mere idea of the money exchange? Jews from all over the world come with various currencies. They would come with Roman currency, Greek currency. They come with Jewish shekels. They come with this, that, here. They come with all the different coinage that was prevalent in the ancient world. Of course, it was obligatory for the Jews to make a financial offering to the temple, which went to the support of the priests, after all. But that was a corruption, because the law of Moses says that there were 12 tribes of Israel, and 11 tribes got the land. The priestly tribe was to be supported off of the 10% off of the proceeds of the other 11 tribes. Where did it say go into the temple and buy a turtle dove, buy a lamb, buy a sack of grain, wheat, whatever, barley, and for a sacrifice on the priest of the Lord? Not part of the Moses, but they invented this in order to make money on the deal. And not only did they have a currency exchange, but they charged interest on that currency exchange. That was the beginning of Jewish banking. Turn the church into a money-making, cash register, teaching. But this was the day when Jesus entered triumphantly, as was to fulfill the prophecy that the Lord shall enter through the sheep gate, riding on the foal of an ass. This was prophesied some 500 years before, and yet it was fulfilled in the person of Jesus. Yet another prophecy fulfilled in his person. this idea that he was entering through the one gate that the high priest would enter every year before the celebration of Passover. Yes, yes, the high priest who sat on the mercy seat. He was, that gate was only used one time a year. And there were the people waiting for the great high priest to go out there so that they could cheer the parade, the procession of the great high priest coming in to offer to get it ready for the week prior to Passover. And what happened? Jesus came through instead. First. And the people cried out, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Hosanna to the King of the Jews." You know how jealous that high priest was? Those Pharisees. Who is this usurper, this man from Nazareth? Who is this man that could possibly come in and rob me of my moment? This is my night. This is my day. When once a year I can come through and be seen by all the people. And they said to him, "Jesus, look what the people are saying to you. Make them stop. They're calling you king." The children cry out. And if they didn't cry out, even the stones of this place would cry out. This is the triumphant day. We worship Jesus as king, but we worship him as God in glory. We worship him as the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. The Lamb on Passover that was sacrificed. The Lamb who fulfilled not only the intent of Passover, but the actual literal interpretation of it. That he himself would be the Passover Lamb. What does it mean by the Passover Lamb? Who remembers the story of Passover? Passover was when the Israelites were captive in Israel and in Egypt. Israelites were captive in Egypt. They were held as slaves in bondage. And that, Moses had gone and said, "Let my people go." Gone to the Pharaoh and said, "Let my people go." "No, no, I won't. I need them. They're slave labor. My markets will go, my economy will falter. I need that labor for free." He said, brought about the seven plagues. And the last of the plagues, of course, was the spirit of death. And Moses was told, "Take one pure, spotless lamb and slaughter it and paint the blood of that lamb on your doorposts so that when the spirit of death comes upon this generation and this land, that it will pass over you. You will be free from death." And so they did. And that is the Seder lamb, the Seder dinner. That's where we have lamb on Holy Thursdays. It's a custom. The Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. I mean, take away the sin of death. Taking away the sin of Adam and Eve who had transgressed. And by their transgression, death came into the world. But he was the Lamb of God for all of mankind that would liberate us all from death. You say, "Are you saved?" Yes. When were you saved? Well, I was saved on October 12th, 1975. Yes, I was saved last year. Okay. I was born on the 10th of October, 1952. I was baptized on the 2nd of November, 1952. I was 3 weeks old and I was baptized. So, according to that, I'm saved. And saved from what? I asked. Saved from what? Saved from death. We Christians who are baptized are saved from death. Are you saved? What are you saved from? Saved from death. Our sins? Yes, the death, sin of death. Consequences of sin are death. The wages of sin are death. We're told, we by our faith are saved. The sacrifice done, the Lamb of God. So Jesus, triumphantly entering, knowing that the war was already won. Just these final battles had to be worked out. The healings in the temple. The teachings in the temple. The Last Supper. This is my blood which is poured out for the forgiveness of sins. This is my body which is broken for you. And then the passion. Mighty sacrifice. Under the end that has ever been and the end that ever shall be. The one who died for all, so that all might live. He, the Passover Lamb, who bled out for our sake. He knew that this was yet to come. But today, he would not be denied his glory to enter into Jerusalem triumphant and being cheered by all the people. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I have yearned for you. How I have yearned, oh Jerusalem, to gather you as a hen gathers her chicks. Oh, Jerusalem, you are precious, my son. Jerusalem. The city on the hill. Even now, if you go to Jerusalem, you see the golden dome. You see the city. It's magnificent to behold. You can look out. I remember looking out from my hotel room, the King David Hotel. And I was there, and I looked out and could see the whole Kidron Valley. And in my mind, I saw the river. The river that the angel had prescribed, the river of life. I could see it. But it was not a river of water, it was a river of blood. Because so many, I could hear the cries of everyone who had been killed, run through with a sword. Everyone who had been murdered in that city. More lives have been sacrificed in that city than you can count. The valley is running with blood. See it. The cries of all those who said, Lord, mercy. This day of triumph is a day that we shall never forget. It is a day of like the army going through the Arc de Triomphe in Paris. Omar Bradley, the head of the column, with Charles de Gaulle. The whole American army marching through where Hitler had marched through just 4-5 years before. They took it back from the evil one. And they had liberated it from the evil that was the fascists, the Nazis. The slavers, the ones who were who conquered the world through murder, and death, and fear. But we, in Christ's name, have overcome this. We've won the war, not for more fear and death and bloodshed, but by faith, by love, by compassion, by our purity of heart. These are our weapons. These are our weapons. The cross of Christ, the palm branches that signify Hosanna to the God of glory. We have won this battle. Do you see? We've won the war. You are triumphant in eternal life. You have conquered death. If you are baptized in this holy name, you have entered into the kingdom of life and life eternal. And so we act like it. Christianity is a religion where we are known by how we act, how we treat other people, how we regard one another. This is Christianity. Not those who adhere to the doctrine of God. Doctrine of God is important. But the heart of Christianity is the heart of Jesus that loves, that sacrifices, that does unto others as he would have done unto them. He who hears the law and goes and does it. He who hears the word and goes and does it. He who hears what the Spirit is calling him and answers it. This is Christianity. It's triumphant. You must feel victorious today that no matter what comes in our life, no matter what battles, what depression, no matter what assault, no matter what trials and hardship we must go through, you already won. And it shall not be long before it's fulfilled in you. But it can be fulfilled in you today, this instant, this moment. You don't have to wait to die to go to heaven. You can experience heaven now. You can experience it in your Christian mind. Your godly awareness, your divine in this, I ask you to know that Christ Jesus is alive. And we know that today he is triumphantly entering into Jerusalem to take possession of his Father's house. And here you are in it. Your house and his house. It's a place where you can come into knowledge. You can come into acceptance. You can come into healing. You can come into forgiveness. You can come into mercy. And you can be, you can come to the living well and draw from it. This is the way in which Christians have seen this day for 2,000 years, since the day he entered into the sheep gate, since the day that he actually took possession of his Father's house. And they dared not challenge him. So this, we will have a blessing of the palms in a little while. And you'll take your palm branches and you'll wave them. You'll say, Hosanna to the King of Glory. And you can know in your heart that you mean it, that you love him, because you know what love is. We Christians are known by the way that we know what love is. You know what love is. I know you do. Love is a selfless sacrifice. It's easy to sacrifice yourself for someone you really love, that you know, your daughter, your son, your mother. You can sacrifice yourself for your husband, for your wife, for your family, your loved ones. But to sacrifice yourself for someone you don't even know, but you know that Jesus loves them as much as he loves you. So that you should be able to say, I into your hands I commend my spirit for the benefit of that person who I don't even know, and those people yet to be born, which we certainly do not know. The sacrifice of a contrite heart and a broken spirit that shall not be spurned. This is your work. It's your identity. It's your purpose. It's by which you were born to be in this time and in this space right now. So that you can announce that Jesus Christ is Lord. Hosanna.